Well, good morning. Yeah, I would go ahead and join us in standing as we open up in a word of prayer. Lord, we thank you for today. We thank you for your love, your mercy, and your grace. Right now, we give to you, as we lift our hands, we lift our spiritual eyes, and just reminded of what you've done for us. Lord, we love you, and we give this time to you. In Jesus' mighty name, we all pray.
Our power, I'm sinning darkness, His love is mighty.
just worship you right now. As we just sang, for God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son for me, for you, for you, for the woman down the street that feels that she is alone, that she is unworthy of his love. Lord, you never forsake or forget about your children. So as we sing this next song, that we sing, oh, what a Savior, the wonderful, wonderful name of Jesus. So we worship you right now. Speak. sing that line one more time, that this is our story, that this is our song today and every day that He has called us. This is my story.
Savior, we have. So good to see all of you today. I want to welcome you that are here in person, also those of you that are online. We've had a lot of people that are sick this week, some that are out of town. Some of you are watching online, and so we want to say hello, good morning to you. Thanks for watching online, and we pray that you get well soon and get back with us. But we're so appreciative of all of you, and just a couple of quick things that we want to talk about. Last week was Easter, and you know, during the Easter season, we have what's called an Easter offering, and during that time, we ask you to give specifically to that, and that money goes towards outreach. And I just want to let you know, because today, I'm like a proud father today for several things, and one is just your giving. So far, and I know there's some more being given. We have given $2,606 to Easter, to Resurrection Seed. So, yes, you can clap for that. Because that's almost $1,000, I believe, than we've ever received before. And so, y'all, we're coming out of COVID, and we're coming out of very difficult times. And so, man, what exciting this is, that all this is going to go to outreach and just allow us to do bigger and greater things. So, thank you so much for your giving. And if you haven't given and you are giving, just make sure that you designate it. Use the envelope, write on there Resurrection Seeds, so we know that that's what you're giving to and that goes directly to that and towards outreach. So just make sure you mark it somehow. Anyway, you can put RS, Easter, anything like that on there so that we know. Also, one of the things that we do, and we haven't been able to do this in the last year because of COVID, but one of the things that we do here is we have a ministry rally. And a ministry rally is to reward everybody that serves at the church. And we do those on a Sunday. And so next Sunday at 6 o'clock, it's an hour and a half, and we feed you, and we give you some inspiration and some encouragement, and we also share with you some important things about what's going forward. And so we haven't been able to do those because of COVID, but next Sunday, we're getting back into our rhythm, doing what we're supposed to do. So the ministry rally next Sunday, it's at 6 o'clock. It goes to about 7:30. We sit down and fellowship together. It's a good time of encouragement and fun and team building and also just casting some vision. And we feed you. So, hey, you got to eat anyway, so why not eat here? And if you are new and you're not in ministry yet and you would still like to get into ministry, then come too, because you'll find out more about it. So you're more than welcome to come. That's next Sunday at 6 o'clock. Wanted to let you know about that. If you are new, especially online, if you're new and you've never connected with us, we would love to connect with you. And you can text the word welcome to 864-840-8089. You can do that anytime during the service. You can do that anytime during the week, and you'll get a text from me. And one of the things we do at Hope Church is for the people that are new here is we make a donation to a local nonprofit charity. And so if you're here in person, if you're online, if you're here in person, you can take the card back to guest services. There's a list back there. You mark it on the card, and then we make a donation to that local nonprofit charity. If you're online, you can just text that word there, and you'll get a text back from me, and just keep following the prompts, and you'll get an email. It'll list them, and just reply back to the email, and we'll make that happen. So very important things. The other important thing is this is a fun day. This is an exciting day, because this is a day that we are welcoming new members into the church. And most Most all churches have been through a very trying season. A very trying season, and still are through going through COVID and still going through COVID and trying to get people back. And there's a lot been going on. Even today, I said there's a lot of people sick. Some are out of town. They told us that. And some of you are watching online. But today we get to welcome new members into the family. And so in just a moment, we're going to ask you just to come stand down front, because there's more than we can even probably, we'd probably go all the way across the stage and we still wouldn't be able to get them in the camera shot. So we're not going to be able to see anybody in the camera shot, because believe it or not, this is our biggest group of new members than we've ever had. And it's a new season, in the church. And so as far as I could tell, in 2016, we have a class of 12. Today we have a class of 15, And as you look around, it's pretty much all of you that are here. But you know what that tells me? And so before you come up, let me speak specifically to you. Because I really feel that God is going to use this group of people to take this church forward, to take it into new places. As I said, COVID has been difficult. COVID has been hard. And there has been a lot of pruning going on. But do you know when the Lord does pruning, it's for new growth. Amen. And I really believe that God is going to use all of you in a special way. Amen. You're diverse. You're unique. With a lot of different backgrounds. And I am so excited and so humbled to be able to be called your pastor. And so today's probably going to be the day of a lot of tears, and you'll find out why in a little bit. I'm humbled, but I just want to say to you that this is the beginning of something that God wants to do in your life. And I really believe that he wants to use you, because you're not joining Hope Church to sit in a seat. You're joining to get into the game. You're joining to be a part. You're joining to take this church forward. And God is going to take his church forward, COVID or no COVID, whether it gets worse, no matter what happens here or there. God's going to take his church forward. And he's looking for people that are willing to sacrifice. He's looking for people that are willing to go all in, And you're that group. And so I'm excited today to be able to welcome you in and to pray for you and to ask God to help me and to ask God to help the rest of us and our leadership to nurture you, to guide you, to equip you, to pray for you, and to just be there for you in any way that we can. That's part of what we're going to pray in just a little bit, for God to help us. And then we're going to pray for God to help you to find your place. I think today may be one of the most important messages that I've probably maybe ever shared in my 21 years of ministry. And it's not what I was going to share when I mentioned it on Easter. It's something very, very personal. But I believe when we talk about communion, when we talk about family, when we talk about new members, this message is going to resonate in a very deep way in your life. And so we have for you not only a prayer, but we have a packet down here, a membership packet, and in it there's some goodies. There's a very little short book in there about what happens when you begin to serve in a local church. There are some wristbands, each one reach one, when it's like, who are you going to invite now? Who's going to be here because of you now? Who do you want to bring into the family? So there's some of those in there. My card's in there. It has my personal cell phone number in there. Listen, you need me, you text me, you call me, and I'm here for you. I'm here for you in any way that I can. That's in there. There's a certificate in there, whether you're an individual or a family, with your name on it, with today's date, just welcome you into the church, and it lists the team norms that we talked about, the membership norms that we talked about as we went through Growth Track. And then there's a sticker in there. I don't know anything else in there. Maybe $100. I don't know. Yeah, I do know. I'm lying. There's no $100 in there. I do know. But you're worth way more than that. And this is more valuable than that. And so I'm going to ask all 15 of you, I think you're all here, to come down and just to line up here, face that way. and we're going to pray, and then I'm going to pass these out to you. So go ahead and come and stand, and we are so excited. So come on, don't be shy. Don't be shy. Look at this group. Look at this group. Look at this group. Y'all, there's a lot of people watching online. Some are out of town. You can see everybody wave at them. Wave at them. Wave at them. I'm so excited about all of you. And so those of you that are watching online and those of you that are here, if you don't know these people, you need to get to know them. You need to spend some time now to get to know them. And some of you, right, may not even know each other. But you come from a lot of different backgrounds. And so I'm going to pass these out to you. And if you're married, you have one for your family. There you go. That's yours. There you go. Terazinski. Terazusi. See, this is why I try, because I know everybody's name here, but I'm like, I'm not even going to try, because I might get nervous or something and mess something up, and then like, see what I did? I messed it up. See, I messed it up. This is one of our newest attenders. This is, her name is Patricia Crow, and I talked to her earlier, and I said, you go by Patty? She goes, yeah. She said, I only get called Patricia when I'm in trouble, so I said, don't call her Patricia. This is Patty. And this couple here has a big day coming up soon, very soon, May 1st. They're getting married. Congratulations. So excited.
We just got married on February 14th.
So excited about all of you. Man, you look fantastic. And so I am so humbled to just be called your pastor and just to see in this next year, what God is going to do in you and through you. Because I believe it's a new place today. It's going to happen. So those of you at home, those of you that are here, join with me in asking God's blessing upon this group of people. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for this group that's before me today, for these new family members, brothers and sisters in the Lord. Such diversity with different backgrounds. And Lord, we celebrate that diversity. Thank you for bringing them to us. Now, first, I pray that you help me as their pastor to lead them in the way that they should go, to equip them for ministry as I've been called to do, to love them, to pray for them, to watch over them, and to bless them in any way that I can. Father, help us as a church to reach out to them, to include them, to nurture them, to love them, to welcome them, and just to undergird and strengthen them in any way that we can. And Lord, now I pray for them. I pray for them. First, Satan, they're under our covering now. You have no authority over their lives. They're under our covering. I command you to get out of their homes, to get out of their lives, to get off of their children right now. They have come under our covering. And so we take authority over them right now, and we speak health and healing and deliverance and salvation for them and their household.
Yes.
Now, Lord, raise them up and use them in a great way. Use them in a great way. Help them to discover their gifts, their talents, to be faithful, and to make themselves, Lord, available, to be equipped. Use them, Lord, in a great way. In a great way. And may they take this church to a new place and to a new level. Lord, we love you and we thank you for them in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. I'd love to hug every one of you next because of COVID, though. I won't do that. But again, welcome. Welcome to Hope Church. We're so glad that you're part of this family. Hey, there's some tears already going on, man. We're going to have some fun today. I love you. You may be seated. Hey, this is an exciting time. This is such an exciting time. At the end of the service, we're going to share another very special time together in communion. In communion. Before we start, just in case. Just in case. So before we start, let me pray again. And let me pray for God just to direct this part of the service. Those of you at home too, put every distraction aside. You need to focus in on what I'm about to say. Because these very words could help you understand your life in a way that you've never understood it before and take you to a place that maybe you've never been before. So let's focus. Let's pray. Father, we pause right now in this very, very special day, a day of family, that your spirit would just be here in a rich way. I pray that you help me, Lord, to communicate what I need to communicate today and say what I need to say today. Amen. And I pray that as it's spoken, that you will give us ears to hear, eyes to see, and a heart that's just tender before you. Lord, for those that are here today and for those that are watching online, I just pray that you would move deep within their heart, deep within their spirit. Speak as only you can speak. And I ask this in the name of your Son, Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. So last week I said I was going to start a new series called More Than Forgiveness. I am so excited about this series called More Than Forgiveness. But we're going to hit the pause button today. And because of the new members and communion and also what I'm going through in my life right now, some things I'm discovering, today's going to be kind of very different and also very personal. And I'm going to share something from my heart with you. And it's something that I'm just kind of learning and walking through too. But I believe you need to hear this. I'm taking a few classes from Southern Wesleyan, and one of them is called Launching Your Ministry. I really think the title really doesn't give justice to what the class is all about. The class is all about. In this class, we are to create what is called a vocational credo. Now, you may not understand what that is, but let me just explain that a little bit, because when I first heard it, I'm like, what's a credo? I didn't know. It's kind of a purpose statement. But a vocational credo is a carefully crafted statement that describes one's purpose for existence. Your vocational credo describes why you are here on earth and what you're going to do about it. And so as we begin to talk about this and read in our book, and we have what's called a live expert, where we have a Zoom call that where we all get together and we get in, and this live expert, this is the person that wrote the book, talks to us about this. Begin to talk about this triangle. Everybody in here knows what a triangle looks like, and if you just can think with me for a moment about the shape of a triangle, to understand your vocational credo, talks about three points of the triangle, and one is kind of your core values. And so it says, look back in your life and say, what is valuable to you? What is important to you? What kind of issues and things in your life are important to you? And I really don't want to talk much time about that. But then the other thing, and this is where we're going to go today, is she says, you need to look back in your life to discover your first pain. Your first pain. What happened in your life where you first felt pain? It might have been when you were a small child. It might have been something when you were older in life, somewhere later in life. But it's something that happened early in your life. And it's also something that happened repeatedly in your life. And so when we begin to talk about pain, we begin to look back in our life and we begin to see what is it that caused us pain, and then we begin to see there's probably a pattern there. And so as we look back at that pain, then and this is not easy. Some of you are already tearing up, and then I'm probably going to be right there with you because I'm going to share mine with you. But as we look back at this pain, then she says that you need to label at least three emotions. What did you feel when that happened? What was your feeling? What were you going like? What was your feeling? List those three emotions. But then here's the thing. There's a purpose behind all of this. And here's the thing. Again, think about the triangle. There's the core values, and there's this pain in my life. But then this is the thing, is that you take both of those things and you take the emotions from that pain, and God wants to use that to change the world. To change the world. God wants to use that to help you discover how he wants to bring not only healing to you, but healing to others. And so you ask yourself questions like this. What keeps you awake at night? What brings you to tears? What makes you angry? What makes you angry? For which people group do you feel the most compassion for? The most compassion for. And then I like this one. What would you do to bring healing to their broken world? So here's my story. And this is important because, one, I'm your pastor. And I want you to understand how God wants to use me, but how God wants to use you, and how God wants to use us here at Hope Church. In other words, when I stand up here and talk about diversity, when I stand up here and talk about such a welcoming church, you're about to find out why I'm so passionate about it. You're about to find out. So here's my story, and I'm kind of going to read this so that I stay on track, because it's very personal. And I'm kind of going to read what I wrote and try not to wander from it. Maybe just have a seat here and just read some of this to you. And as I read it, think about your own story. Maybe think about my story. Think about what I went through. But as I think about this, it's not easy, right? To think about pain. Who wants to bring up pain? Matter of fact, in the Zoom call, as we begin to talk about it, and as I begin to open up and talk about it, my teacher said, it's very unusual, you're a pastor, and said most pastors love to talk about core values and how they want to change the world, but they want to skip right over their pain. And I was trying to zero in on it. Why? Because it's part of my class, and it's a grade, I got to do it, but also I just think it was important to see how God wanted to use me and wanted to use me. And so here, let me share some things with you. Growing up, going through life, even today, I always felt different. In high school, we had our jocks, we had our preppies, we had our rednecks, or should I say our country folk. Is that better? I don't know. Can I say rednecks? We had those groups of people. I didn't fit into any of those. I had friends in all of those groups. I hung out with all those groups, but I didn't fit into any of those groups. Another thing was, I was always the small kid. And as I went through life and went through high school and different ages, I always felt like I was kind of the round or the square peg that would not fit in the round hole. Just would not fit in, just was different. And I was, as I said, the small one. And so what being the small one puts a target on your back. Because that means you're the one that can get picked on. That means you're the one that can get made fun of. That means you're the one that can get bullied. And that is the truth, and that's what happened to me. I was picked on. I was bullied. I was made fun of at times. And as they looked at a group of people that I hung around with, they always thought at least I was the one they could go after because I was the smallest one. At least they thought that was their easiest target. They thought it was. Another thing about me too is that I've always been a learner. I've always been a reader. And I've always had a passion for truth. Even when I was not following Christ. And when I heard something that wasn't correct, I would correct it. And so I got labeled again as a know-it-all. You're a know-it-all. Not that what I was saying was not even not true. It was true. But it's like people don't want to be corrected. And whether it was, I'm a big sports guy, and I was always reading, and I can remember talking to some relatives, and we were traveling to the Clemson football games, and they would say stuff, and I'd be like, well, no, that's not what I read, because this is what they said in there, and this is what. And so I've always had this thing inside of me, and I really see this is where the importance now, because I don't like kind of gray areas. It's right or it's wrong, and I stand for truth. And so growing up, I did a lot of standing up for truth, and people didn't like it. And so they're like, oh, you just a know-it-all. You just a know-it-all. Again, what kind of emotions, though, does that make me have? Does that make me feel? It's rejection. You ever felt rejected? You ever felt rejected? When I became a little bit older, I rededicated my life and I got back into church. And it was a little bit of time where my pastor said, and this was a big church, a growing church in Anderson, and he said, I want you to lead our singles group. And we had a good singles group. We had a growing singles group. But God got a hold of me in a very powerful way. And I began to make choices in my life, and there was certain music that I would not listen to, and I would not go to rated R movies, and I wouldn't watch rated R movies. And so here I am leading this singles group, but God had called me to be a single holy person, and he was really dealing with me, I mean in powerful ways. And I was making changes in my life, but all these other singles were doing all these different things and getting together and wanting, well, it's movie night, but they want to watch this rated R movie. I'm like, God's dealing with me. I'm not, if you want to do that, it's okay. That's you. I'm talking about me. I got to follow how God's leading me. And even though as the leader, there were some things that I would not associate with, and there's some things that I would not deal with, and there's some things I would not listen to. And of course, joking, I was not around that. I would not listen to that. And so again, I felt isolated. I felt rejected. I felt different. I felt alone. Even though I'm leading the group. I feel like, again, I just didn't fit in. Even when I became a pastor, again, felt like I didn't fit in. When I first started pastoring, I was single. Very unusual to be a single man pastoring and leading the church. Again, very, very different. A single lead pastor. And so it was kind of odd. So we'd go to meetings and stuff, and guess what? Everybody's sitting there with their wife, not me. Everybody's sitting there with a bigger church, but I've got this little small church, because the first church I pastored was meeting in what's called a mobile chapel. It's the church that didn't have a pastor for a few years. They had lost their way. The building was falling apart, and I said, yeah, I'll take it. Yeah, I'll do it. But that was very different than any other church. That was very different than any other church building. It was very different than any other church in our Anderson Seneca section in this denomination that I was in. It was very different. It was very different. So I felt out of place. And then I eventually got married. And after almost 10 years of marriage, my ex-wife said, I don't want to be married anymore. And refused to reconcile the marriage. Another period of deep hurt and rejection. Has that word come up yet? Rejection? Rejection. And so now, I'm a divorce pastor, another label. Another label. That's the divorce pastor. That's the one that his wife left him. After a little bit of time, I remarried this to a beautiful young Latin woman. Some of you may have met her. But remarriage is a problem in some denominations. And because you're divorced, you can still pastor here, but now you're remarried, you can't pastor anymore. So 15 years of my life, three buildings that I overseen and built, I now had to leave and walk away because I was remarried. Rejection from my church. Rejection from my denomination, rejection from people. See a theme here? So, we begin to look, to pray, to find a church home. In a roundabout way, we found a Wesleyan church that loved me, that cared for me, that believed also that God still wanted to use me. And so I took another pastoral position in a new denomination to a small church that didn't have a pastor that had kind of lost its way too. This church became known, what you are now sitting in today, as Hope Church. I was the single guy. I was the new guy. I was the small church pastor guy. I was the divorce pastor guy. I was the remarried pastor guy. All labels, all unique in different situations. All situations that created all these emotions in my life. So Tuesday night when we're on this Zoom call, I'm there in front of all the class. We're all Zoomed in. And they give a time for questions. And so my question was, because as I look back to my first pain, I had a good childhood. I have godly parents, and I look back, and I didn't really see, you know, like some people, like, oh, my parents were divorced when I'm five. That's huge pain. Some people look back, like the author of this book, she was sexually abused. And she was told, if she told anybody, that her family would be harmed. And so they tried to shut her voice up. And so she looks back in her past, and it's very easy. Boy, it's very easy to pinpoint those things, right? And I look back, and I'm like, I'm struggling a little bit, but I want to be true to this course. And so I asked the question, and so she asked in front of everybody right there. She says, okay, what's your pain, Eric? What have you thought about? And I begin to share some of the things with you, some of the things that happened. She says, okay, now, what's your emotions with those things? What did you feel when you got picked on? What did you feel when others made fun of you because you were small? So I had to pause. Because this is where we don't want to go, right? Right? You don't want to go there. Because it hurts. And I paused. And I began to think. And I began to tear up a little bit. And I said, well, some of the things that I've had to go through in my life, here's what I listed. Rejection, hurt feelings, loneliness, feeling like I didn't measure up. You ever been there? Just don't feel like you're good enough. Feeling like I just didn't fit in no matter where I was at. No matter who I was around, just different. Just didn't feel like I fit in. Even as a pastor. So when you go back to this triangle and you look at core values and you look at pain, even though it's hurtful, what God wants to do is to take that pain and to use it to bring healing to your world. He wants to use it to help others. Dan Allender says, whatever has broken our heart is meant to arouse our anger, because one of the emotions that I said to her is anger, and because it makes me mad when people are mistreated. It makes me mad when you make somebody feel like they don't fill in. And she said, wait a minute, that's a secondary emotion though. That's your pushback emotion. That's what you use to change the world emotion. Because it makes me mad when somebody's picked on. You pick on one of my kids, it makes me mad. I don't care if you're 13 or 14, I want to pop you in the jaw. I want to have a talk with your mom and dad. I don't care who you are, man. Don't be making fun of my kids. Don't be putting them down. Who are you to decide they're small? That's the way God made them, and God didn't make a mistake. That's the way they made. Who are you to decide? And I tell my kids all the time, most of the time when kids are making fun of you, it's because of the hurt that's in them, and they want to put themselves, put you down to make them feel better. So you just realize that that's what's going on with them. So he said that anger is your pushback emotion. That's the anger that God wants to motivate and use you to change the world. And so when important to Hope Church and important to us is when I look at my life And I see people in our community, and I see your family member and friends, and some of you watching at home, and some of you sitting here, and I see that you feel like you don't fit in, or that you may be different, or because you've got tattoos, or maybe something's happened to you in the past, or maybe you got different skin color, or multicultural families, or things that's going on, you feel rejected, and you feel lonely, and you feel hurt. I realize that God wants to use that here at Hope Church to bring healing to our community and healing to people. And so you understand when I talk about these things and why I want to share this with you is that anger comes from all these emotions, and I see how God, and listen, I've never thought about this before to this last week. And no, it ain't fun. Because I'm sure every one of you here feel like at times you just don't fit in. You feel like you don't fit in. And there's a word for this, and it's realized that people that feel this way, they feel marginalized. And so I'm familiar with the word, but I looked it up, and it means people that are pushed to the edge of society by not allowing them a place in society. In other words, it's people that try to say, well, this is the way the world's supposed to be, and you're different, so you need to go over here and stand. And you're not a part of my family. You're not a part of my team. You're not a part of my life because you're different. You're not a part of my world. And so they push them all to the side. So there's people that are marginalized. And one of the things, if you even look at the history of the Wesleyan Church, is they were always helping the marginalized people. They stood up for the abolition of slavery. They stood up for women in ministry. They stood up for the people that didn't have a voice. And that's the other thing that I wrote down in my notebook but didn't put in here. As I began to think about all these things, I said, when you're rejected, when you don't feel like you fit in, you know what it makes you want to do? It makes you want to be quiet, right? Is you just kind of come back over here and you sit down and you just don't say anything. And when you're pastoring a small church and maybe other people have bigger churches, you're like, you just want to sit and listen. But I'm telling you right now, I'm tired of my voice being shut up. And I'm tired of Hope Church's message being shut up. And we're going to let Oconee County know that this is a place of reconciliation, of love, of acceptance, of healing, of hope, of passion, of purpose. And if you're marginalized and you're different than everybody else and you feel rejected and you feel lonely and you feel like an outcast and you're hurt, then this is the very place you need to be, right here. Right here. Right here. I read a few things, and I looked up a few things, and I read a few things this week, and they kept talking about rejection, and here's something they kept saying about rejection and not fitting in. They kept saying, you need to quit trying to fit in. But wait a minute. What I want to say to you is a lot of times we're not trying to fit in, but people are rejecting us and telling us we can't fit in. And so society tells you you don't fit in whether you're trying or not. You're just trying to live your life. But society comes to you and says you don't fit in. People come to you and says you don't fit in. And then listen to me. Churches make people feel like they don't fit in. Yeah, it happens. Churches make people feel like they don't fit in. And so, yeah, I understand that to some people you're trying really hard to fit in, but some people just trying to live their life, and society's pushing them down, and people are pushing them down, and churches are pushing them down, and they say, oh, well, we don't let people like you in here. Well, why not? Because Jesus was found with tax collectors and sinners, and he ate with them, and he went after the marginalized. He went after those that were different. Jews didn't associate with Samaritans. Jesus said, I'm going through Samaria. What? Like a white boy with a tie and a suit on trying to walk through the hood. Uh-huh. That's what Jesus did. Jesus said, I don't care. I got to go through there because there's somebody that's been marginalized and is hurting. And I need to reach them. And I need to reach them. I'm just going to tell you when, and I hope you're understanding where I'm coming from, is what I believe God wants this place to be, and that's why I'm sharing with you. As you look back over your life and you see different things, and I can't begin to tell you how many pastors' meetings I've sat in, and I felt this big. I felt this big. How many gatherings I went to and nobody bothers to come talk to me. Nobody bothers to include me. Rejection. I don't even know if that's I guess I'm walking with this and I can't wait to talk again, but I guess the whole thing is this, is just don't fit in. So what does that mean for us? That means this should be a church to where everybody feels like they belong. Where everybody feels like they have a place. I'm not saying we're perfect. I'm perfect. I'm not saying we're doing the best job on that we can do, but I believe today's a turning point. All you new family members, this is what I want you to understand, and those of you that are even watching at home to understand, is that you need to understand what I've been through in my life. And so when I'm passionate about reaching people, when I'm passionate about diversity, and when I'm passionate about including those that are different, and I say things, it's not just a flippant little saying. It's because God has taken things from my past, and it makes me very angry when I hear that in a church nobody talked to them, or they wasn't accepted because their wife was black and they're white, or he was Hispanic and she's white, or their kids are different color, and so they walk in and they're like, whoa, we don't let your kind here. Or maybe they've got too many tattoos or too many earrings, or maybe they've got too much of a marked past, and we look at them, well, we don't allow your kind here. Well, that's pathetic. And I want you to understand that when I say things like that, it's with a heartfelt emotion when I say, bring us the broken, bring us the rejected, bring us the hurting, bring us the outcast, bring us those that's been rejected by church, that's been hurt by church, that's been hurt by other peoples. Bring us the ones that look different. Bring us the ones that feel different. Bring us the ones that have been had rejection in your life and isolated, like I didn't fit in anywhere in my life. Because when you go, I work in Michael's, if you know. And I see people walk in there, and it's evident sometimes that there are people that feel like they don't fit in anywhere. Extremely, extremely different. I would love sometimes just to say, hey, you go to church anywhere? Come to Hope. Because we'll love you. We'll care for you. So our goal, those of you that are new to the family, is to make this a loving place. To make this a welcoming place to those that have been marginalized. To welcome those that feel rejected. To welcome those that feel like they don't measure up. To welcome the hurt. To welcome the lonely. After all, isn't that what Jesus did? But there is something I need to say about this. Sometimes when we think about these categories that I'm talking about, we look too much on the outside. Because the wealthiest person in Oconee County can feel this way. The beauty queen pageant winner can feel this way. And I'm telling you this because you don't know when somebody walks through the door what they went through in their past. You don't know when somebody walks through that door, and you talk about greeters and how important, you don't know what they've been through. You don't know how they were treated in other churches. You don't know what they're going through in their life. And they may come in with a suit and tie. They may come in and they may be driving a Bentley. They may come in and be driving an Escalade. They may come in and you think, man, that's like the beautiest woman I ever seen in my life. Just don't tell your wife that, but just, you know, don't. You know what I'm saying. On the outside, they may look like they have it all together. But on the inside, there's loneliness. There's brokenness. There's rejection. Do you know there's so many sports athletes and millionaires that commit suicide? Do you know why? Because everything I've been talking about you right now, they don't think nobody cares. They don't fit in. They've still been rejected in their life. They're in a different place in their life, and nobody is there just to love them for who they are, not what they have. And I'm telling you, is you don't know when somebody walks through the door what they're going through. So we don't judge by the outside. We just make sure that this is a loving, welcoming, safe place for people to receive hope and grow into everything God wants them to be. I'm going to give you one passage of scripture real quick, that goes along right with this, and it's really all about what I've been saying. And it's in 2 Corinthians, and it's chapter 1, verses 3 through 5. And it said, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies and the God of all comfort. He comforts us," now don't miss this, "He comforts us in our afflictions," all our afflictions. Why? "So that we may be able to comfort those who are in any kind of affliction through the comfort we ourselves receive from God. For just as the sufferings of Christ overflow to us, so also through Christ our comfort overflows." I want you to think about that scripture this week. Leave it up there just for a moment. In those verses, comfort is mentioned 5 times. And when you study the interpretation of Scripture, words are repeated for a purpose. And they're to emphasize importance. And so the word comfort is mentioned 5 times there. And what this passage of Scripture is saying is exactly what I've said. Is God wants to use the pain that you've been through to comfort other people. And no, it's not easy. And yes, it hurts to think about. And yes, when you connect with those emotions, it does hurt. But this scripture is saying that we are called alongside of pain and suffering to bring comfort in the way we ourselves have been comforted. And so what it means is God wants to use our pain to help other people. And so there's 2 options. We can allow pain to bring us to a place of bitterness, and a lot of us end up doing that. Or we can allow pain, when we realize it, connect with it, and see what God is doing, to come into our lives, and if we'll pay attention to it, we can use it to develop empathy and compassion for others. I don't really have time just to say real quick, as you can think about, it's very painful to lose a child for any reason. But I'm telling you, it's the compassion and the empathy you have once that happens for somebody else that's done, you could never ever have if you hadn't experienced it yourself. And as tragic and as hurtful it is, and as tragic as hurtful as some of the things that you and some of the things that you at home went through, God wants to comfort you in that and to heal you in that. Are you seeing this to change the world? So God wants to take you to a new place. And so when we think about that, we've got to think about our church. We've got to think about what God wants to do in you and through you. So here's a couple of application points. Number one is I want to help you develop your own life credo statement. So Wednesday night, I'm going to walk you through this. Wednesday night, I will email out a link to you on Zoom, and I will walk you through. It's very easy steps. It's not easy to do. And you're not going to have to do it there in front of us. I'm just going to give you the steps to do this. Share some more information with you. I want to help you. Second thing is I want you to be intentional about creating a loving, welcoming environment here at Hope. I want people to say that no matter what I was going through, that I came in and I was different. They loved me. They cared for me. They welcomed me. They invited me into their church. They invited me into my family. They invited me into cookout. They invited me to ministry. I want you to be intentional about creating a loving, welcoming environment here at Hope. And then thirdly, I want you to be intentional about inviting those that may be marginalized to church. You don't have to look far in your own life to see people that are kind of getting pushed to the side, that are different. You don't have to look far. They're all around you. There's actually probably not one person that's watching today or one person that we even know, or you here today, that haven't felt some of the things that I've talked about. So be intentional about reaching out to those. Look for the person at work, at school, in the grocery store, in your neighborhood, that maybe nobody else is associating with. Take an invite card and invite them to church. Be intentional about it. As I close today, before we share communion, I hope today what I have shared brings us closer together. I also hope it brings unity into making this church the type of church and the place that I know God wants it to be. All of us here at one time or another have felt like we didn't measure up. We felt the pain of rejection and the pain of loneliness. So stop with me for a moment. Just imagine if this group of people that were up here early, just y'all, if you chose to be serious about looking, and a lot of your core values come off that pain. It's like, what's important to me? Again, who's the people group that's important to me? What would I do to change their world? If all of you got in touch with your past this week, and you looked at your pain, yeah, you can weep over it and cry over it. Yes, please do. Whatever you feel, just let it come out and let it flow and let God just heal you. But then realize that God wants to use that to change the world, to change your world, to change other people. And instead of maybe being in a place of bitterness, or maybe like being like me at times, just being quiet about it, it's like, you know what? I'm going to speak up. I'm going to pray for people. I'm going to bring healing. I'm going to share my story. I'm going to get involved in that ministry at the church because I have a passion for those. And maybe it's kids, and maybe it's greeters, or maybe it's something else. But listen, we all have a story. And what would our church look like if all of us got really serious about this and let God start using us in this way to bring healing to those around us? Can you just sense the move of God right now like I do? Just to sense the move of God, where you're not sitting on the sidelines. Because see, you all have the pushback emotion. It may be anger. I told you mine's anger. I get mad at racism. I just get mad, especially in the church. I get mad. That's my anger. That's my pushback emotion from it. I get mad. See, all of you have got that pushback emotion. It's a secondary emotion, but that is to motivate you and to drive you to do something. It's like, this does not need to ever happen again. This needs to change. These people need healing. These people need deliverance. These people need love. You know what I'm saying? And I'm taking some time there. You know what I'm saying? Because God wants to, it's not just me. It's you. It's you at home that God wants to use. Change the world. And he does it through your pain. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for this day and this word. It's a very difficult word, but something that we need to grasp to change us. I pray today, throughout this week, you would help each and every one of us, Lord, to take time to go deep within the pain, to realize what we've been through, but also, Lord, to grasp and be real about those emotions. But then, to turn it around for the glory of God. Amen. I pray that this group of people, Lord, will make a difference in our world. Will make a difference in this church. Bless each and every one of us today, Lord. Be with us as we walk through this journey. Use us for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen.